A very good morning, students. From today onwards, we are going to start with our Unit 3, which deals with the violation of human rights and the grievance or redressal mechanism available for the violation of human rights. So the first topic which we are going to discuss is about violation of human rights, how rights could be violated and who all are responsible for this. So basically, there are three, we could say, parties to it. That is, the violation of human rights can be done by three organisms, three institutions or individuals. The first one is government, another one is some groups, or the third possibility is that some individual is also violating the human rights, doing the violation of human rights. So first, we need to understand what is the meaning of violation. The act of doing something that is not allowed by a law or rule, whatever laws or rules are framed by the government, if somebody is not following those laws or rules is known as violation. Other one, the act of ignoring or interfering with the person's right. If anybody has been given some rights by the government, by the law, and some other person is interfering into those rights, that is again violation of the rights of that individual. Then the third one is the act of showing disrespect for something. If government, if the law, if the constitution has given right to equality, and if a person is not respecting the equality of a human being, that is also violation of human rights. Now, what are the different forms in which rights are violated? First is discrimination. If somebody is discriminated from others, if some groups are discriminated from other groups, this is one of the form of violation of right. Second is exploitation. Exploitation is mental or physical harassment of an individual. Any act which is against the wish of an individual is known as exploitation. Then is deprivation. If we are not giving what a person deserves or what is his or her right, that is deprivation. Then is neglect. If we are neglecting the development of an individual or of a group, that is violation due to negligence. And last form is violence. If somebody is doing violence, physical or mental violence against some individual, that is again another form of violation of rights. Now first we'll discuss violation of rights by state, because it is a major part through which the rights of individuals are violated. The first and foremost is repressive nature of state and its coercive machinery. Repressive means suppressing nature of government, and coercive machinery means the machinery which do certain things forcefully. And what are these reasons or these factors which are showing that government is suppressive or government do some forceful actions by which the rights of individuals are violated? The first one is forced eviction and displacement. This we have discussed many times in various disadvantaged groups in the previous unit also. Many a times government, for various reasons, for developmental reasons also, they forcefully make the public, make a particular group or some individuals to evict their places or displace them from one place to another place. This is the violation of their rights. Then second one is deliberately skewed allocation of resources. The resources of a country are supposed to be for the betterment of each and every individuals. And if they are deliberately skewed, skewed means they have been deliberately made preferably utilized for a particular group or particular individual, that is skewness. That we have seen skewed curves which are towards a particular edge or having a specific inclination. So, inclined allocation obviously is not for the betterment of the masses. So, in this, prioritizing the wealthy over the poor, if the government officials or the leaders, they are preferring the wealthy community over the poor, and they prioritize the interests of functionaries and bureaucrats over the needs of the population, this is skewing the allocation of resources, that too deliberately. Then the third is elite capture. Elite is the group which is influential. It includes the rich people, the leaders, the bureaucrats. All these people come into elite group. So this is influential detention of state resources. If the government resources are detained for the utilization to this elite group, This is again violation of rights of masses. Powerful people like superior social, political or economic status people have uneven influence in the development process of the government. What they do, they influence the processing or functioning of the government through their power. This power could be monetary or this power could be political power. Then the fourth factor is unequal impact of macroeconomic policies. Whatever macroeconomic policies government frame, it is not necessary that these policies affect each and every individual or each and every sector equally. For some sectors, it could be very beneficial, and for other sectors, it could be not as much beneficial or maybe sometimes harmful also. Even when government policies appear to be neutral, they often reflect an inherent bias toward one group over another. So here the game comes. Sometimes government, due to their selfish motives or some inherent benefits, they generally do what they do. They make such policies which look to be neutral, but actually these are biased for a particular one, biased for a group. And obviously because of those policies, that group is benefited and all others are at a loss or at a harm. Or impose cost on group who are already marginalized. Marginalized means disadvantaged. So these kind of policies further affect the disadvantaged groups negatively. Then is unfair international trade rules. What happens in a country also happens internationally. Like the rich exploits poor, or the government frame policies for the betterment of rich in the similar manner at the international level. Sometimes the international trade rules are such influenced that they are for the betterment of already developed nations, and underdeveloped nations suffer because of these rules. Rich countries keep their market closed and keep out the goods of poor countries through tariff barriers, despite of promotion of free trade policies. We all know internationally free trade policies have been promoted by all developed nations. Still, the rich countries, they have different kind of mechanism by which they keep the goods of poor countries out of their markets by increasing the tariff rates. And its imposition on poor countries, obviously because of this, the poor countries suffer. This would be considered as violation of their duty to respect the human right of people living in other countries, right? The people who are living in underdeveloped countries or in poor countries, their rights are hurt or violated because of the lack of duty or because of non-fulfillment of the duties by the rich countries. This is known as extraterritorial obligation. It means the duty of a nation outside the boundaries of its own territory. Then the next one is the role of armed and paramilitary forces in the violation of human rights. Armed forces are also facilitated with Armed Force Special Power Act, right? AFSPA. And this Special Power Act has been given to armed forces because in many situations, armed forces have to go to extra limits, or they have to do some extra effort to reduce the terrorism or to reduce the negative forces in the country or to capture the enemies. So for that, they require certain extra powers. Otherwise, it won't be possible for them to do this particular task, which confer vast power on them to be deployed in disturbed areas. The areas where major disturbances in forms of terrorism or some other activities are there, there these powers are given to armed forces. According to AFSPA, armed forces have following powers in disturbed areas. What are those powers? First is, they can fire upon or use force, even to the extent of causing death, against any person who is acting in contravention of any law. In the disturbed areas, if any person is acting in contravention to any law, or against assembly of five or more persons, or in possession of deadly weapons, in this situation, if a person is found, the army has a power to use the force or to fire upon them, even to the extent of causing death to them. Second power is to arrest without warrant. Otherwise, in normal situation, arrest is not allowed without warrant. And with the use of force, forcefully they can arrest them, anyone who has committed certain offenses or is suspected of having done so. It is not necessary that the offense has been committed. if the offense has not been committed, but there is a doubt, there is some information, there is some suspect that this kind of activity is going to happen, on the basis of suspect also, the arrest could be done by the army. Then to enter and search any premise in order to make such arrest, they have full power, full autonomy under these powers, special powers, that they can enter any premises, any religious premises also, and they can search whatever information or whatever person they are trying to find out. And then this act gives legal immunity to the armed forces. Legal immunity means no case, no civil case or criminal case can be launched in the ordinary courts against the armed forces when they are using these special powers. Now, what happens because of these special powers? There are certain cases which have been reported, and they show that these powers have been misused by the army people. Various cases of misuse and human rights violation have been reported by various human rights organizations in this context. Like civil killing and firing, many civilians are killed because of such firings. The firing which has been done either for counter-terrorism or for the encounters of terrorists, whatever is the scenario, there are many civilians, innocent civilians, who are killed because of these encounters. Second is torture and custodial killing. There are many cases where the killing of people in the custody have been reported, right? Civilians suspected of having information about militants, many of them innocent, maybe they are innocent. It is not not obvious that if somebody is arrested, that person is 110% a culprit. This is only on basis of some suspect or on basis of some information. They arrest them and they ask them. But in this scenario, many a times the torture, the level of torture is very high, and because of that torture, many killing in custody occurs. So they are routinely detained, tortured and killed in custody beside militants. Then disappearances, lots of cases of disappearances have been filed by the civilians, and these disappearances are because they have been arrested, they have been taken away, their family members have been taken away by the army people without giving any explanation, without giving any reason, and they are never returned back. Nobody knows what happened to them, are they alive or not. So these kind of cases have been reported by many of the NGOs and human rights organizations. People are arrested, detained or interrogated without following any lawful procedure, and these people many times misuse their special powers, and because of that many disappearances have occurred. And the last one is rapes also. Then preventive detention law, we have studied about preventive detention law in unit 1 also. These are the laws which govern the cases where a person is arrested to prevent some event or to prevent some kind of mishappening. How one can say that a person will do crime in future? Obviously, in preventive detention, it has been said that because that person is supposed to, or some information has been given that this person could do some criminal activity in future. So it is not sure that person will definitely do a crime in coming future. Maybe his mindset will change before doing such activity. So unlike ordinary arrest or imprisonment, preventive detention is effective without trial. In this, no trial is done and directly that person is arrested. It is completely against the democratic constitution, because in democracy everybody is given right to speak about his or her point. Such law should not be used in peacetime. So it is an argument which has been given that such law should not be used while in peacetime. Article 4 of the International Convention on Civil Political Rights says that right can only be limited in time of public emergency. Whenever emergency situation is there in the country, only then such laws should be implemented, because these rights are against the democracy constitution, right? So remaining points we'll discuss in next video.